Now let's look at working out with the final element, which is the balance sheet. Now that we have a P&L statement as well as a cash flow statement, my intention is to make a balance sheet and probably make sure that it balances the assets with the liabilities. Once I have that particular aspect, then there whatever the financial statements I have prepared, they are of more and more of a comfortable level. So that is what we'll try to work out on our spreadsheet. We will create one separate sheet for balance sheet, and the first two aspects are more or less the same, which I would repeat across, saying if, right, you remember all these aspects. If this is blank, leave it as blank, otherwise point out to this particular value. So the first two things of my sheet are more or less common across, and this is where I will work out for the next thing. So now I will work out on the liabilities plus the owner's equity part, wherein I will have the scenarios of debt, right? I'll have the scenarios of debt or outstanding loan. I'll call it as loans outstanding, or I have the scenario of equity capital as well as the reserves. These are some of the key items, right, that are going as a part of our, we also have a scenario of overdraft. So even let me cover the overdraft also, because that's also a kind of a liability existing for a certain period of time. So this is what will result in total liabilities plus owner's equity, which is outstanding at the end of each period. And at the same time, I can look out for the assets, wherein my focus is on fixed assets, the net fixed assets, which would be post the depreciation. So I'll take it as the net fixed assets. And now that we have done some lease deposit, the deposits are all assets for us. So I'll take care of lease deposits. Similarly, the DSRA is also a kind of an investment account for us. So I'll consider DSRA as an asset, and even I have cash, which would be considered as an asset. And remember, as a part of balance sheet, all of them need to be the outstandings. It's not for a specific year. I have to consider the outstandings as of a particular period. So that's where I'm considering the total assets. Total assets is always a summation, or similarly total liabilities is also summation with respect to the previous. Alright, so now let's see, or probably we'll also have one balancing figure for a checksum, which simply looks at the difference between the liabilities and assets, or assets and liabilities, just to make sure that we are not missing out on any of the elements. Okay, first let's start with the loan outstanding, where we talk about the borrowed money as well as repaid amount. So during, or whatever is the phase, we have got into the borrowings as well as the repayment. So all I can think of is, okay, the summation of what is my borrowing. My borrowings part is present during the construction phase, right? So the debt from here to here, whatever the borrowings I have done, I am considering that part, summation of the construction part borrowing whereas, and at the same time, I'll take the summation of summation. So I'll take the summation of the construction cost borrowing, and at the same time, the operations. In the operations, I am doing a repayment. So what I could take is the summation of whatever the repayments I am doing in each of the years. So probably I'll take the loan repayment, because it's already in the negative terms. I'll take the loan repayment with a dollar sign here, which means I am doing a repayment, as well as I'm counting the total loan taken and the total repayment done, which is giving me the outstanding loan. So for the first period, my outstanding loan is coming to be something like this. Second, yes, 75.3. Third, again 75.3, because I don't have a principal repayment. But from the fourth year, or from the fourth year onwards, there is some principal repayment going on. So probably it is, oh, here we are getting zeros, fair enough, because we don't have any loan to be repaid, because the loan got completely repaid by the 14th year itself. The loan got completely repaid. The loan outstanding at the end of the 15th year is becoming zero. But slight adjustment, what we can very well do is, if this is blank, I will retain it as blank at least, so that I don't get so many zeros even beyond the period. So just that cosmetic things we may have to work out. Beyond this period, I won't get any kind of loan outstanding. The equity capital, the same logic I can use, right? The equity capital also, I'll use the same logic, just like the way I have used for the loan outstanding. Probably equity capital plus reserves, I don't need separate. Let's look at it. If I am including the reserves here with the same kind of mechanism, I think I don't require the reserves as a separate element at all. So here also I'll take the summation of the equity capital, which is coming during the construction period, right? The equity capital is getting during the construction period. I'll take the summation of the equity capital that is getting during the construction period, as well as the reserves that are getting built from the P&L statement here. The reserves that are getting built on a yearly basis, which is coming out from the profit after tax. So if at all I am considering these two things directly, probably yes, here the equity capital is 23, the next year's, yes, 50, there is a loss, so 46, again a loss, 46. And after that, again it is picking up. So the same logic I can put here also. If this is equal to blank, retain it as a blank, otherwise do this entire calculation. So with this is actually equity capital plus reserves. So I don't need to worry too much about the next line now. The equity capital plus the reserves is working out to be this, which means I'll remove the reserves element altogether. And overdraft, I can directly pull out the overdraft directly from the overdraft cumulative column. So from here, if this is equal to blank, replace it with a blank, otherwise pull out this value. This will come out as my outstanding overdraft. Okay, so up to here, when I'm looking at, these are contributing to my overdrafts each of the periods. So probably I'll get in with the formatting part. So these are the overdrafts, and similarly I can put up the total liabilities and the owner's equity, saying if this is blank, retain it as blank, otherwise do the summation of all these. Otherwise, do the summation of all these. What happened? If, let me just try it out again. If this is blank, replace it with a blank. Otherwise, do the summation of these. All right. So, these are what are my total liabilities plus owner's equity for this entire period. Right, it's better that I highlight all these things in a number format. Okay, so in the first year, my liabilities and owner's equity are working out to those kind of numbers. Now let's look at the assets part. The assets part is nothing but the worth of the assets in the first 2 years, or probably when we go with the lease deposits and all, we can directly update. We directly take the lease deposits. We will directly take the lease deposits, saying if for the operations period, I can start off with my lease deposit. So if this is equal to O, what I can look at is whatever was my lease deposit, right? This is my lease deposit. But out of this lease deposit, 0.52 was already capitalized, right? So probably the better way to talk about the lease deposits is from the cash flow statement. It would be better to take rather than from that particular sheet. I'll take the lease deposits probably from change in lease deposits. So probably I'll take the lease deposits from this element. I sum up, right? So what I'll do is I will do a summation of, from this onwards, I'll do the summation of this lease deposit, because the first 2 years we have capitalized. Either I do that lease deposit, subtract 0.52 from each of the years, or I do a simple summation of lease deposit from this particular location and probably put up a minus on the top of it. So let me just try out how is it working out. Yes, 0.03 0.05 0.08. yes, very much. So the lease deposits also I can do it this way. Okay, all this case it is coming out to be minus. Minus 0.63. Why is this lease deposit coming out to minus 0.63 here? Okay, first let me put up if this is equal to blank, leave it as blank, otherwise do this. So when I'm looking at this part, up to here there's nothing, and here it is coming out to, for the last year, the lease deposit actually should come out to be zero. Okay, let me work out on that. Similarly, when I look at the DSRA account, otherwise we'll say if it is the last year, make it as zero. Okay, if I'm going ahead with the DSR, probably it is worth saying, in the last year it is zero, or the other way what I generally suggest is, because 0.52 of this lease deposit actually got capitalized, it's better that I remove that. But in my formula that is not getting addressed, so that's where I am trying it out from the cash flow statements here. Similarly, when I go with the DSRA, we already have computed the cumulative DSRA here. Right, we have computed the cumulative DSRA here. So I'll go to this cash flow statement, DSRA requirement. If this is equal to blank, I'll leave it as blank. Otherwise, I'll put up this. So the DSRA in this case, if I see across, I'll get my DSRA values updated to all these. So all these years at zero, whereas in these years, these are my DSRA requirements. Similarly, the cash outstanding also I can pull up from here itself, the total cash that is outstanding, the total cash surplus cumulative. If this is blank, leave it as blank, otherwise point out to this value. So even this cash outstanding or cash surplus is what I can consider in this, working out to these are the numbers as a part of my cash surplus. And now I can look out for my, okay, when it comes to the fixed assets, we have, for the first 2 years, I can take the assets exactly in the same manner. So if I say, if this is equal to C, I'll consider the assets exactly in the same manner as my debt and equity. Right, if this is equal to C, I'll consider it exactly the same. Whereas if this is equal to O, what I would be doing is, from whatever the fixed assets value until the previous year, I will subtract the amount that has been depreciated in the current year. Whatever is the outstanding as of the previous year, I will subtract the depreciation of the current year. This should suffice. The summation of B5, B6, yeah. Otherwise, I will leave it as blank. This is what I will follow. Alright, so let's try to update it now. If this is C, I will do this. Else, if this is O, I'll do this. I don't need this part. So here the fixed assets are coming out to be something like this. And when I go down, yes, these are the values of the fixed assets. They are getting depreciated. And probably when I'm dragging it till the last, now I can add up the total assets, saying if this is blank, leave it as blank, otherwise do the summation of my total assets, which will be something like this. So this is the summation of my total assets, yes, matching, and probably across also I am doing the same task. So this is my total assets across the periods. And what I am typically looking at is, as a part of the checksum, I am simply looking at, if this is equal to blank, leave it as blank, otherwise take the difference between the liabilities and the total assets. So yes, wherever it is coming out to be zero, we have done the balancing quite properly. But wherever it is non-zero, something has gone wrong as a part of our model. So once we have prepared the cash flow statement as well as the P&L statement quite comfortably, what I generally see is the balance sheet can work out quite comfortably for us. right? Once these three financial statements are done, you can do any kind of ratio analysis or any kind of valuation piece on your financial statements. And that is what now we are going to do, finding out the IRRs and the NPVs of the project, both from the project standpoint as well as from an equity standpoint, and finally work out with what is the real profitability of the project. I hope you are comfortable in terms of working out with the balance sheet. In case you have any further queries regarding the same, you can get in touch with me by giving me a call on this number, or you can send in an email at vamsidhar@pacegurus.com. Thanks a lot for listening to this session. Thank you very much.